Hello, everyone, and welcome to our Sustainable Activism webinar. My name is Lisa Levinson. I'm your host and the director of In Defense of Animals Sustainable Activism Campaign, providing emotional and spiritual tools for animal activists. And we're super excited today to have Ellie Laks, the founder of The Gentle Barn, join us. I'm going to give you a little bit more information about her before we get started today. Thanks again for joining us. So, Ellie, she's going to help us with some concrete rescue tools to stay uplifted while we manage the sorrow and overwhelm that we face having these huge hearts in an oftentimes cruel world. The Gentle Barn Foundation is a national organization that rescues and rehabilitates unwanted animals and heals people with the same stories of abuse and neglect. Ellie is a celebrated animal welfare advocate, humane educator, and author of My Gentle Barn, Creating a Sanctuary Where Animals Heal and Children Learn to Hope. The foundation has animal sanctuaries located in California, Tennessee, and a new one in Missouri. So it's really our pleasure to have Ellie Laks here with us today. Hello, Ellie.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's such a treat, and I know what you're going to share today is going to uplift all of our souls. We were so happy to have you as part of our Hope for Animals Summit last February, and folks really benefited from what you had to say. So thank you for joining us again.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So whenever you're ready, we're all ears.
Oh, okay. How do I start the slideshow?
There we go. Looks good. We're seeing it.
Okay, good. So I think this is a very important topic, rescuing the rescuer and how to keep our sanity when our hearts are open. Especially now, I feel like there are so many more natural disasters and so many more acts of violence that's being reported around the world. And people, I think, are searching for answers. And I think people are feeling hopeless and scared. And when we do animal rescue and our hearts are open and we see the travesty happening around us and we see people that are not responding to the pain of others, it can wane hard on our hearts and it can make us weary. And I think the most important thing for, I like to call us light workers, for people who have open hearts, for people who feel the pain of others, for people who want to be as kind as possible, I call us light workers. And I think for light workers, it's so important to stay strong and to stay motivated and to stay centered so we can do our work. We have come here. Yes, it's painful, but we have come here to essentially save this planet, and we have come here to lead others and to awaken others. And so if we get weary and defeated, then we'll have done nothing. So it's really, really important for those of us around the world that have open hearts, that feel the pain of Mother Earth, that feel the suffering of animals, that see the despair in other human beings. Yes, our heart hurts, but we have to find ways to stay strong and stay motivated so that we can do what we've come here to do, which is to save the planet. So my journey started when I was a very little girl. Actually, the first time I tried to kill myself, I was 7 years old. And basically, I had had enough after 7 years of being on this planet and seeing the way that people treated each other, seeing the lack of voice and respect that animals had, even at seven, being aware of the people around me and seeing how they did not see animals the way that I did, and they did not have open hearts, and they were not considerate of the feelings of others. I had had enough. And so at 7 years, I tried to take my own life. Sadly, because I was only seven, I didn't know how to make it work. I tried a number of things and it just didn't work and I couldn't get out of my body. Very, very upset, very frustrated. I went to the garden sobbing hysterically, not knowing what to do or where to turn. And it was a hummingbird that saved my life. A hummingbird flew within inches of my face and stayed there for what seemed like forever. And he just thumbed his little wings and he stared into my eyes I recall his vivid reds and blues and greens and yellows like it was yesterday. And it was like he was saying to me, you need to stay, we need you, and it's going to be okay. And he called me back to the earth, and he made me feel noticed, and he made me feel wanted. And I felt a connection with that little hummingbird and with all of nature like I had never felt before. And I felt this strong calling inside me to make it better here. Well, if I can't leave, then how can I make it better? If I can't go, then how can I make a difference here? If I can't alleviate myself of the suffering of others, then how can I make their suffering better? So that was when I resolved to stay on this earth and try to make a difference. And when I would play in the woods and the lakes around my house, when I would find birds that fell out of their nest or turtles with broken shells or animals that were clearly in need of help, I would bring them home. And I kind of thought, well, I will just make a difference wherever I go. And if I see someone in need of help, if I see someone hurting, then I am going to be the difference. And by the time I was almost 8, I had decided that my little plan was to have a house full of animals that I had saved and they would be my friends. And so I just wanted to go out into nature and find those that were needy, and I wanted to bring them home so I could heal them. Well, sadly, my parents were not on the same page as I, and they did not want a house full of animals. My poor parents had their hands full with me and my brothers. And so they would get rid of the animals when I was at school, and I'd come home to find them gone. And it hurt my soul so badly. And I would say to them, how can you do this to me? And they would say, Ellie, when you grow up, you can have as many animals as you want. And I would say, you'll see, when I grow up, I'll have a huge place full of animals, and I'll show the world how beautiful they are. So even at that very young age of 7, I recognized that the people around me did not see life the way that I did. And they did not recognize the intelligence and the affection and the importance of animals the way that I did. And they did not have reverence for the earth the way that I did. And I was painfully aware of that all the time. And it made me feel very alone, because everyone around me did not feel the same way as I did. But it also made me feel very resolved to do something about it. So I would yell at my parents that when I grew up, I'd have this place full of animals, and I'll show the world how beautiful they are. And funnily enough, I was so resolved to make a difference in the world, and my heart was so open, and I was so connected to animals and nature. But even at that young age, I still ate meat. I still ate what was served to me at the table, and I did not know what was being served to me. I just thought it was food, like most of us do. Most of us are just not connected and not informed. And it wasn't until I was 11 years old that there was a chicken in my school. And she was in a cat carrier in the corner, and she seemed very, very, very scared. And I went to her as all the other kids were screaming and running on the playground, and nobody even noticed her. And I went over to her, and I pulled her slowly and gently out of the cat carrier, and I cradled her in my arms, and I told her that she wasn't alone and that I was there with her, and it was going to be okay. And I smoothed her feathers down, and I rocked her in my arms, and I whispered sweet things in her ear, and she stopped shaking, and she settled in my arms. And a few minutes later, the principal came in and said, you've got to give me the chicken. We've got to take her to the slaughterhouse. And she ripped the chicken from my arms, and she grabbed the cat carrier and walked out of school. And my little 11-year-old brain tried to figure out, what in the world was she talking about? What did that mean? And I figured it out. That chicken was chicken and rice. I thought it was a coincidence that there was an animal named chicken and there was a food dish named chicken. And I, in that moment, realized that it was those beautiful animals that were being killed to make chicken and rice. And I was so upset. And I went home that day and I told my parents I would never, ever eat animals again. And my mom said, well, that's nice, dear. Eat your soup. And I said, didn't you hear me? I'm not going to eat animals anymore. And she said, well, it's not an animal. It's just soup. And I said, aren't you listening? That's chicken in the soup. That's an animal. They have the same feelings, the same intelligence that we do. I'm not going to eat them anymore. I don't want to hurt them anymore. And then, of course, my parents freaked out, saying that I was not going to grow, and I was going to be anemic, and I was going to be sick, and I was going to have physical problems, and I need the protein. And I just dug my heels in and I stood in my resolve and I said, I will never harm another being as long as I live, even if it does take my own life. Obviously, I'm almost 50 years old and I made it quite fine. I grew just fine. I'm more healthy than most. And then I was at school dreaming of a gentle barn and figuring out how to create a gentle barn, how to save animals. But I had no idea how to do it. I didn't know how to raise the money. I didn't know how to get the land. I didn't know, I had never even met a farm animal until that point. And so I kept drawing pictures of what the gentle barn would look like at school. And I would dream before going to bed each night of what the gentle barn would feel like and what animals I could love, but I didn't know how to start. And so I procrastinated for a really long time. And it wasn't until I discovered an abusive petting zoo that I started pulling animals from there. I went there, I discovered it by accident. I was driving down the street and I saw the petting zoo and I didn't know what it was. And it was full of animals and full of people. And so very concerned for the animals there and curious about what they were doing. I went in to the petting zoo just to see what they were doing. And there was so much abuse and neglect there. There were animals in cages that were dying. There were animals that had no water. The ponies were being beaten to go round and round in circles. And I had that moment again for the second time in my life, or the third time in my life, where I could see the suffering in front of me and I could see the misery in front of me, but no one else could. All the other people at that petting zoo were taking pictures with their children. They were putting children on those ponies that could barely walk. They were pointing to the animals in cages and not seeing their suffering. And I couldn't understand why they were blind, why they couldn't see their suffering, why couldn't they hear their desperate cries for help. And it blew my mind, the dissociation and the disconnect between people and animals, or happy people and suffering. They just couldn't see it. And it hurt me so badly. And I ran from that petting zoo as fast as I could. I had to get out of there. And blocking the exit was a very, very old goat. And she looked like she was about to drop dead any second. And she looked me right in the eye and she asked me for help. And it was undeniable. It was so clear. And maybe the other 100 people that were at that petting zoo couldn't hear her, but I heard her loud and clear, and I was not going to turn my back on her. So I looked her back in the eyes and I said, yes, I will help you. Wait right here. I'll be right back. And I went to find the owner of the petting zoo and said, hey, can I have that goat? And she said, no. And I said, well, can I buy her? Name your price. And she said, no, leave me alone. And I said, well, that goat needs help. And I told her I was going to help her. So I'm going to stay here till you say yes. And I came back to that petting zoo for 12 days in a row. I would show up in the morning and I would say, I'm here for Mary the goat. Can I have her? No. Oh, okay. Well, I'll stay here till you say yes. And I did that for 12 days. And finally, on the 13th day, the owner of the petting zoo came up to me and said, lady, take this goat and get the heck out of here. And so I was able to finally take Mary home. And I found a mobile vet to come out and trim her overgrown toenails and remove her horribly bloody pussy tumors. He taught me how to feed her, how to care for her. And a few months later, she was bouncing around the backyard as happy as can be. I had a little house with a little half-acre backyard, and I brought her home and I fixed her. And a few months later, she was bouncing around the backyard as happy as can be, and it was the greatest feeling of my life. And I had been calling authorities on that place to see if they can help make conditions better. And Humane Society, Animal Reg, SPCA, they all said the same thing. They all said, we know about her and there's nothing we can do. And it broke my heart again. Why were people so willing to call themselves animal protection agencies, but they weren't willing to do anything to protect those animals that were right in front of their faces? So again, I said, well, then I'm going to do something about it. And I went back to that petting zoo. You can imagine the owner's face when she saw me coming again. But she said, what do you want? And I said, I know that you have other animals that are suffering. No questions asked. I'll take them off your hands. And she said, fine, wait right here. And she went in the back of the petting zoo and she started dragging animals out to me. Broke animals with broken bones, pneumonia, scared to death and dying. And she gave me this huge big pile of animals. And she said, fine, here, you can have them. And so I took them all home. And the vet came out and helped me fix them and taught me how to care for them. And It was the most amazing feeling of my life to be able to do something, at least something. And then a few months later, I woke up in the morning and I looked out my backyard that was now full of animals, and it hit me like a ton of bricks. I said, holy cow, I just started my dream. And so that's how the Gentle Barn got started 18 years ago. And we've been going strong ever since, rescuing animals that nobody else wants, healing them, fixing them, breathing life back into them. And then we reach out to at-risk schools, foster homes, drug and alcohol rehab centers, domestic violence shelters, war veterans, senior centers, inner city schools, anyone that needs help and healing and unconditional love. And we invite them to come heal with the animals. And the healing that takes place both for the animals and for the people is miraculous. But you know, I was vegetarian since the age of 11, but it wasn't until I first started the Gentle Barn that I went vegan. Again, I didn't know. So I just started the Gentle Barn, and a group of vegan activists reached out to me and said, hey, we're having a meeting. Can we meet at your place? And I said, of course. And they came out to that meeting, and one man wanted to get to know me. So he came up to me and said, hey, are you vegan? And I said, no, I'm American. And he laughed and he said, no, do you eat animals? And I, with great pride, told him that I stopped eating animals at the age of 11. And he said, yeah, but do you drink milk and eat eggs? And I said, yeah, but that doesn't hurt anybody. And that's when I got the biggest eye opener of my life, when he described to me that the only way to get milk from a cow is when a cow is pregnant, because that milk is breast milk, just like with any other mammal. Dogs have milk for their puppies. Giraffes have milk for their babies, humans have milk for their babies, and cows have milk for their calves, and at no other time. So he explained to me that the only way to get that breast milk from a cow is to impregnate them and then take away the baby and kill the baby and then steal the milk for humans. And I just couldn't believe it. It seemed so obvious when he said it, and I was kind of beating myself up for not knowing that prior. Like, why hadn't I figured that out on my own? And so I went vegan right then and there, and I've been vegan now for the last 18 years. In that first year of opening the Gentle Barn, it was both the most wonderful, amazing, blessed time of my life, and it was the hardest time of my life, because on one hand, I was finally set on the track that I had been born to be on. I had been lost so much in my life, and I had procrastinated for so long, and I didn't know how to start, and I finally had started my dream. I was finally living my purpose and fulfilling my destiny, and I was able to take animals in and heal them and breathe the life back into them and give them the life that they deserved. And it was the greatest feeling in the world. I keep thinking back to that hummingbird that made me stay, and I kept feeling thankful that I chose to stay, and now I was finally making a difference and doing something. But at the same time, I was being accosted with misery and pain and agony wherever I looked. I would rescue animals and heal them, yes, but I was seeing the worst of humanity, and I was seeing people that were willing to do the most heinous, cruel things. And I was learning more and more. Every time I thought that I had seen the cruelest, most horrific thing ever done to an animal or a human, then the next day or the next week, I would hear a story more horrific. And my heart was breaking with each story and with each encounter. Until one day, I finally had had enough. And I had this overwhelming feeling of remorse. And I started screaming to spirit, saying, I am not strong enough for this. I didn't know it would begin to be like this. I made a mistake. I've been dreaming about this for my whole life, but I made a mistake. I can't do this. I'm not strong enough. I'm not made for this. I'm not built for this. I am not going to survive this. And spirit kept coming back very gently, saying, yes, you are strong enough. Yes, you can do this. And I kept saying, no, I can't. I changed my mind. Someone else needs to do this. I can't do this anymore. I made a mistake. And spirit kept coming back saying, no, this is why you were born. This is why you're here. You have to do it. And I screamed at spirit, and spirit screamed back at me for weeks. And at the end of it, I finally conceded to, yeah, you're right. That's why I'm here. This is the only thing I've ever wanted in my life. This is the only thing that makes me feel alive. It's the only thing that makes me feel like I am making a difference. Okay, fine. Clearly I have to stay and do this, but how am I going to make it through? My heart is breaking. I'm losing faith in this life. I am losing faith in humanity. How am I going to make it through? And I kept asking spirit that, and I kept seeking guidance in my meditations, and I kept seeking wisdom before I went to bed at night. Maybe I would get guidance in my sleep, in my dreams. And over the course of a few months, I developed five things that were going to keep me sane. And I want to share them with you because it has helped me make it through. We just celebrated the Gentle Barn's 18th anniversary. So it helped me make it through the last 18 years. It helped me open a Gentle Barn in Tennessee and open a Gentle Barn in Missouri. It has helped me heal hundreds of animals and open the hearts of hundreds of thousands of people. And so I want to share it with you because whether you own a sanctuary or you're just somebody that loves an animal in your home, if you're someone with an open heart, if you're someone that feels the pain of others, if you're someone that suffers in this world because you want to see it be more peaceful and more gentle, then maybe these five things will help you too. So the first of the five things that I came up with to keep me sane in this world with my giant heart is to surround myself with positivity. You know, I've heard a lot of people say, oh, this world is terrible. Oh, people suck. Oh, this world is awful. You know, a lot of big, broad statements about the state of the world. And I think that's true. I think that if you're looking for proof and evidence that this world is horrible, you're going to find it. But I also think that if you're looking for proof and evidence that this is a beautiful place, I think you're going to find it too. Now, the media loves to sensationalize drama and horrible events. So what makes the news is horror, pain, suffering, fear, drama, trauma. That's what makes the news. But what often doesn't make the news is everyday heroes. There are people all over this world right now as we speak. And as a matter of fact, every one of you, of the listeners listening tonight are heroes. Anyone with a big heart, anyone that wants to help, anyone that cries from joy or from misery, everyone that whose heart goes out to someone else, you're heroes as well. And there's heroes everywhere. There's people that are waking up to veganism every day. There are people that are smiling at someone that's lonely. There's someone that picks up trash even if they didn't drop it. There's people that goes to the beaches just to clean it up, even though they didn't mess it up. There are people that befriend others just because they know they're lonely. There are people that are making a difference every single day. And it doesn't have to be huge. It doesn't have to be because they own a sanctuary or they're giving millions of dollars out to charity. It could be simply putting food out for a stray animal or simply getting a stray animal out of the road to safety or simply calling someone to help when you see someone in trouble. There are so many, many ways that we can help our planet. We can help each other and we can help our animals in our own lives. And there's heroes everywhere. And so whatever you're looking for, you're going to find. So acknowledging that and realizing that, yeah, if you look for the bad, you're going to find it. But if you look for the good, it's everywhere. Then I realized, then let me just look for the good. Let me just surround myself with the good. Let me protect myself from the bad so it doesn't eat me alive and it doesn't stop me from doing my work. So on social media, I only surround myself with positivity. I don't allow negativity in. I don't allow it into my thoughts. I don't allow it into my conversations with other people. I don't allow it on my social media. I protect myself. And all of us have a different breaking point. All of us have things that we can handle and things that we can't handle. So we have to get very clear on what it is that breaks us and then protect ourselves from it. For me personally, it's seeing footage, whether it's a picture or video of like slaughterhouse videos or torture videos or, you know, any of those animal activist videos. If I see it, it breaks me. I go into bed for 3 weeks and I can't function. So for me, I have to protect myself from that. So I don't allow anyone to friend me on social media that's going to share that type of things, because even if I see it for a second scrolling by, it breaks me and it debilitates me and it stops me from doing my work. But there might be some of you that don't feel that way and doesn't break you, and that's okay too. We all have our own breaking points. So that's number one, surrounding ourselves with positivity and protecting ourselves from the things that will break us. Number two is, yeah, we have to be cognizant of the problems. We have to know what the problems are. We have to share it with other people But we also have to be cognizant of the good that's out there. We make so many victories every single day, and I think we get caught up in how terrible it is that we forget to celebrate the victories. And I think it's really, really important that, yeah, we're cognizant of the problems, but we are all celebrating our victories as well. I think within every single movement, whether it's the civil rights movement, the suffragette movement, the white supremacist Nazi movement, whatever movement we're in, whatever change we're trying to create, within that movement, it feels like it's going to take forever. But if we take a step back and look, we can see that we're making progress, even though we still have so much farther to go. So we have to celebrate our victories. The fact that there are 13 European countries that do not allow the production or import of products tested on animals is mind-boggling and will only get better. The fact that India sanctioned dolphins as sentient beings protected under the same laws as humans is amazing. The fact that New Zealand has decided that orangutans are sentient beings protected under the same laws as humans is amazing. There's more vegan restaurants. There's more vegan products. There's more people waking up every single day. The World Health Organization has declared that meat is a carcinogen. We are making progress every single day. And yes, we need to do more, but we need to celebrate our victories. We need to rejoice in those victories because it encourages us to keep going. Number three is we have to share our message gently. I think when we wake up and we know the truth of what's out there, we want to like shake people. We want to slap people. We want to make people understand what we understand. And that never works. It alienates us from our friends because they don't want to even see or hear from us. And it makes us crazy inside. So I think it's really, really important that we share our message gently and we have compassion for the people that we're sharing our message with and we remember what it's like to not know. Every one of us, I mean, there might be some listeners that were born and raised vegan and that's amazing. Oh my God, I wish I was that enlightened. But for most of us, we're born and raised meat eaters and somewhere along the line, we wake up and we find out and we make a difference. And so we have to have compassion and remember what it's like to not know and then share our message gently and kindly. Wait for an invitation and a conversation instead of beating people over the head with our information. And then once we share our information gently, then we need to lose attachment to the outcome. You know, so many times we have a conversation with someone and we let them know all that's going on with the suffering. And then when they don't change immediately or they don't make a change immediately, then we're so furious. Like, why aren't they listening to us and why they don't care? Why don't they care? And I don't think that that's productive for them or ourselves. I think we need to know that every single human being is evolving at their own pace. We all wake up when it's time. We all evolve when it's time. For some people, it's overnight. We hear an information and bam, we're vegan. For some people, they have to get sick before they're starting to look for answers. For some people, maybe they have to come back several lifetimes before they wake up. Everyone is on their own journey and we are all evolving at our own pace. And so we have to deliver our message gently and then let go of the attachment of what they're going to do with it and know that their journey is going to be their journey and bless them on their way. Number four, and this might be the most powerful thing that I do, and that brings me the most benefit. Every single morning when I wake up, I sit in a quiet spot and I set my alarm for 5 minutes and I visualize the world I want to create. I visualize big, beautiful forests that are so ancient because they're protected and allowed to grow. And I visualize clean oceans with coral of every color and fish and marine life that's thriving and bountiful because the oceans are protected. I visualize driving along the freeway and across the country, and everywhere on either side of the freeway are big, abundant gardens that are feeding us. The slaughterhouses are closed down, the cages are open, the animals are free, and there are gardens in every plot of land across the country that are feeding us with fruits and vegetables, and our bodies are healthy and vibrant and energetic. And I visualize herds of horses thundering past because they're allowed to be free. And I visualize people holding hands and embracing each other. And I visualize people holding smaller animals gently. And I visualize people hugging cows and hugging horses and hugging each other. And I visualize a gentle, kind, beautiful world with clean water and clean air and thriving, abundant gardens. And I live in that world for 5 minutes every single day. And then when 5 minutes is up, I go about my day and I spread my message gently and I rescue animals and I heal children and I open people's hearts. And I am working so hard to change this world, but I am working from within that 5 minutes. I am working from that place of being able to touch and taste and smell and feel that world and believe that we can achieve it in our lifetime. I live there for 5 minutes and it fills me up and it gives me hope and it resolves my faith. And then from the belief that we will create that world, then I go about my day. And no matter how bad the day gets, no matter how sad I might be when the day ends, I get to start the next day from that place of hope, from that belief that we are going to have that beautiful world. We are going to create it in our lifetimes because I live in it for 5 minutes every day and I can feel it. And I'm really hoping that you guys will join me, because it will bring you so much joy and so much peace and so much faith to just live in that beautiful picture-perfect world for 5 minutes every day. And then the very last thing that I do is I have analyzed big business. So the fifth thing is just knowing the following. Up until now, big business has ruled the world. Up until now, big business has dictated to us what we eat, what we spend our money on, what's fashionable, what's popular, what's pretty. It has destructed the rainforest. It has enslaved animals. It has caused suffering and pain, and it has caused illness among all of us. And sadly, up until now, we have let it dictate and rule us. But here's the good news, and this is my fifth thing. Big business might rule the world, but we rule big business. We do. If we don't give them any money, they have no power. So if we're the ones that are giving money, then we're the ones ultimately with all the power. And we have that power everywhere we go and everything that we buy and everything that we eat. We are always voting with our dollars and we are always inserting that power. So if you want to take your power back and if you want to create a peaceful world and if you want to help animals and you want to help the planet and you want to help people live more peaceful, gentle worlds, it starts with us being gentle right where we are and voting with those dollars. So if you want to help animals, the most powerful thing each of us can do is adopt a plant-based diet and save 200 animals every single year. If we want to save the rainforest, then we only buy products that are eco-friendly and sustainable. If we want to help our own health and we want to help our communities not suffer so much from heart disease and cancer and diabetes and God knows what else, then we can help our communities adopt a plant-based diet so that their bodies can be healthy and we can celebrate more and we can love more and we can live more instead of suffering so much from illness and devastation. Every single one of us has more power than we think. Every single one of us, by adopting a plant-based diet, saves 200 animals a year. Every single one of us, by adopting a plant-based diet, saves 1,100 gallons of water a day. Every single one of us, by adopting a plant-based diet, saves an acre of trees every year. And every single one of us, by adopting a plant-based diet, reduces our own risk of cancer, heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, high cholesterol level, and dementia. Every single one of us can find peace and gentleness right where we are with our own power and our own power of voting with our dollars. And knowing that we make so much of a difference, one individual, that's a lot of power right there. That's a lot of motivation right there to know that when you wake up in the morning, you have the power to create gentleness right where you are. And those are my five things. and it's helped me survive 18 years. And please God, it'll help me survive another 80 years so that I can have a gentle barn in every state, so we can help people hug cows, cuddle turkeys, give pigs tummy rubs, look in the eyes of these animals and know for certain that we're all the same. We can help people lift each other up and build communities and build gentleness and build health and build a future for Mother Earth, for animals, and for ourselves. Every one of us can start our day and do that all day long, every single day. So those are my five things. And I want to end by saying this. Just recently, there was that horrible, horrible shooting in Las Vegas. And I want to say this. A lot of people have been rocked to their very cores by it. And they don't feel safe. And they're saying this world is so awful and people are so sick. And I want to remind everyone about this. That horrible shooting happened and it was absolutely awful. Yes, agreed. But it doesn't mean the world is awful. It just means that one person is awful. That devastation happened because of one lost, broken, misguided, sick man. So it doesn't mean the world is awful. It just means that one man was very lost and very broken and did a very, very awful thing. But the world is still good, and the world is still full of promise, and the world is still full of hope. And there is goodness wherever we go. We just need to find it and we need to create it. We need to think positive, uplifting thoughts. We need to have positive, uplifting conversations. And we need to do positive, uplifting things with our day, no matter where we are, no matter what our finances are, no matter where we live, no matter what our job is. It doesn't matter. Every single one of us can bring goodness where we are. We can bring peace in ourselves. And we can create goodness just from living our own lives. I hope that brought some comfort and motivation to some of you. And we're really hoping that you guys will come out and hug a cow, because in my worst of times, when I lose faith and I suffer from compassion fatigue and I feel like I can't move on, I go hug a cow or I go sit with grandmother trees, or I go to the ocean, and nature fills me up, and nature reminds me of who I am, and nature gives me strength to keep going. So nature and animals, they're our angels. They're our support. So turn to it when you need it, when you need it most. They're here for us. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Ellie. This is such a delight to have you share your story with us. It's such a beautiful story, and I think has inspired many, many of us. I will ask and invite anyone who'd like to ask you a few questions, whether you're in our webinar right now or even on the Facebook Live. You're welcome to ask questions. You can type them into the comment section or into the chat box. Another way to do this, to ask the questions, is to, if you're on the webinar, that is, you can unmute yourself and ask a question. If you're on the phone with us, you can press *4 to ask a question on the telephone. And if you'd like to turn on your webcam, if you're with us on the webinar, you're welcome to do that too. So just wanted to see if anyone has any questions for Ellie from the Gentle Barn, who is our special guest speaker today on our Sustainable Activism webinar. So let's tune in and see if we have any questions. I will say that there's lots of great feedback. People are saying it's great advice, Ellie. Thank you for being an inspiration. Another person is saying we need many more gentle barns in our world. Thank you, thank you. And many people are also saying that to many blessings to you and to all that you do.
Thank you.
And so it's there's a lot of grateful and joyous people who are participating with us right now. And I just wanted to share that with you. And just to see if anybody who has any questions from our webinar, if you want, you're welcome to ask them. I think there's one coming now. So see. So one One question comes from someone named Susan. She's asking, how do you deal with cats that kill small animals?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question. As a matter of fact, it's a very good question. And I think that that is the dilemma for people who are vegan and have cats. It's a big struggle. I myself don't have any cats anymore, but I did. When I started the gentle barn, I had like 30 cats. And then over the years, they passed away of old age. And my last one passed away 4 years ago, and we decided not to get any more for that very reason. Because I personally don't want to feed them. I don't want to feed one animal to the other. In terms of just the circle of life, listen, I'm not God. I can't comment on why a cat is designed to kill a small animal or a tiger is designed to kill a deer. Like, I don't have a right to comment on that because that was not my design. I could just basically live and let live. I can only be responsible for the things that I choose. So just because a lion might be doing this over there, I still have to be responsible for the choices that I make. And in my life, I choose to go to bed each night knowing that nobody suffered or died for me to live. I mean, would I rescue a tiger that I would have to feed another animal? No. So, I mean, that's why at the gentle barn, we rescue farm animals that are herbivores, basically. But it's an interesting question. I mean, there is the circle of life. I have a theory. I don't know. You know, I don't know what you guys think about it, and I don't know if it's right, but kind of a theory that it looks like the world was created so that there's all these different species, and if there's someone sick or injured, there's another species to take them out quickly. So in the natural design, there doesn't seem to be much room for suffering or old age or dementia or debilitation. It seems like either they're thriving or they're taken out, which, I mean, if you kind of look at it from a very broad view, that looks like a very good design. But I mean, I still choose to be the deer and not the tiger.
Well, thank you for explaining that, Ellie. And Susan, who made that comment, said that this cat that she's taking care of is stray. And she also said that cats tend to come to horse barns that she's noticed.
Yeah. So, I mean, I probably would still help someone if they were coming to me for help. You know, if there was a stray cat that came to me for help, I would definitely find a way to help him or her. Hmm.
Oh. Well, thank you for answering that question. I know it's a toughie. Yeah. There's a couple of other questions, too. Someone asked, like, how do we share and inform people about the suffering that's going on without sharing the videos? Do you have any suggestions about that?
Oh, and just so it's clear, I don't have a judgment on the videos. I was just sharing that me personally, I get debilitated if I watch it. So I protect myself from it. There are people on this planet that need to see it. I mean, there's definitely a use for them. So I'm not judging other people that would share that stuff. I'm just giving an example of something that breaks me. You know, we all need to be cognizant of what breaks us. But I mean, everyone needs to follow their own heart. We're all here with our big hearts. We're all here as light workers. We're all here to share the truth and wake people up gently. And we all have to do it in our own way. So, I mean, if you're called to share video to wake your friends up, then that's what you're called to do. And I think you need to do that. There's definitely a place for those videos. I have met so many people that have said that they adopted a plant-based diet or they changed their life because of one of those videos. So I'm not saying those videos are wrong. I think you share it gently, and yeah, I don't know.
Well, thank you for answering that. That is a helpful perspective, just to know that we're talking about self-care here, and we're talking about how do we protect ourselves, and that's a great skill that you shared with us, so everyone can know that it's our choice whether or not we want to do that, but that the videos themselves may really benefit those people who are not aware.
Yeah.
And then we also had another comment. Somebody was asking about invited you to create a vegan cookbook. She's feeling like it's a struggle for her. She's vegetarian, is having a struggle maintaining a vegan diet, and was wondering about if you or might be interested in doing some sort of vegan cooking book.
Yeah, so my husband Jay is actually creating one now as we speak.
Wow.
And it's going to be amazing. My husband Jay is a vegan chef, and he's very, very talented. And so he is creating a vegan cookbook as we speak. And I'm hoping that it'll be published very, very soon, because it's wonderful. But while you're waiting for Jay to put out his cookbook, I invite all of you to look at other resources, because there are vegan cookbooks all over the place. You go into Barnes and Noble's, they've got vegan cookbooks. You can just type in vegan cookbooks online and see so many resources. It's so easy now. It's so, so easy. There's vegan bloggers, there are vegan YouTube channels. There's vegan people you can follow on Facebook that have meal suggestions every day. We have a vegan part of our website. So if you go to gentlebarn.org, you can go to the vegan part of our website, and we have information, and we have recipes, and we have cooking videos and instructional videos. There's so much information and so much help out there that it's really, really easy to find. And yes, as soon as the vegan cookbook that Jay is putting together is out, we will be screaming it from the rooftops.
Wonderful. Well, that was perfect timing then.
Yeah.
We also have another person who's tuning in from Facebook Live was saying that she had an accomplishment today because she blocked somebody from her Facebook page who was just spewing out lots of negativity, and that I think she was commenting on that as a result of your self-care tools that you shared, just letting go of people who are negative in your life so that she could start to cultivate that positivity and appreciation.
Good job. Good job. And it's hard to do because you're like, oh, I don't want to offend the person, blah, blah, blah. But the truth is that we have to be our own champions and our own warriors, and we have to protect ourselves. We have to. If we're going to make any difference in this world, we have to protect ourselves. And negativity is just, it doesn't create anything good. It creates harm. It hurts. Social media is one of those beasts that you can find information on social media. You can make friends on social media. You can create community and support on social media. But you can also find some really horrible people that say some really horrible things because they can. The slander laws are different on social media. People can say whatever they want. So if you're surrounded by people that are saying horrible things, get rid of them. Here's something that I did years ago, and I'm not saying that you guys have to do it, but it's just something that worked for me personally, is I stopped watching the news. I was like, you know what? There's bad everywhere. Got it. I don't have to keep reliving the fear and the trauma every single day. So I just decided I'm not going to watch the news anymore. I'm not going to read the newspapers anymore. I'm going to live my life. And if there's something that's really, really important that happened, it'll find its way to me. And I have been blissfully in a little bubble for like 14 years now. And if there's something major that happens, you know, somebody tells me. So it's not like I'm missing information. But, I don't know, like for me, watching the news before I go to bed or meditating, watching a show about someone inspirational, reading a book about a memoir of someone that changed the world, going to bed motivated and inspired and excited to wake up tomorrow morning. I mean, which one would you rather do? So I chose the second one, and I stay away from drama. I stay away from negativity. I stay away from fear, and I fill myself up with hope and faith and love and inspiring people and inspiring animals. And I gotta say, I'm pretty happy.
That is great. And I appreciate how you do this intentionally. You know, a lot of times in our lives, we are just tossed about by the winds of what's happening in the world and around us, and being able to kind of empower ourselves and say, I can choose to incorporate some happiness, some gratitude, some appreciation, and live a joyful life.
Yes, our lives are ours for the making. I don't, just like you said, Lisa, I don't believe that we're victims. I don't believe we're leaves blowing in the wind. I believe that we're born and we've come here with a song to sing. We've come here for a message for the world and a purpose. And once we find it, we can deliberately create the lives that we want, wherever we are.
Yeah, that is true. It looks like there's a question here asking about can the government issue stricter laws other than making people felons, like when with regards to animal abuse? So just a person who's asking about animals who are suffering in a lot of different ways, and what are some other ways that we can help these animals?
Well, I mean, like I said, adopting a plant-based diet is the most powerful way to help animals that we have. And there's so many people that say, oh, I'm just one person. What difference do I make? But every single one of us individually rescues 200 animals every year by adopting a plant-based diet. And that's something that we can control and that we can do right now. We don't have to depend on anyone else and we don't have to wait. So, I mean, that is the most powerful way to help animals. And the lawmakers are going to set laws that protect animals based on our demands of them. So, you know, getting involved politically and electing constituents that are going to protect animals and make stronger laws. I mean, that's up to us. There's petitions that we can sign. There's groups that we can get involved with. We can get involved politically and start demanding stronger laws. And that's going to take time. It doesn't happen overnight, but it's something that we all have a voice for.
And I am glad that you've reminded us about this, because a lot of times there's this feeling of helplessness that comes over us when we realize the vast struggle that's going on trying to protect animals in this world, and reminding each one of us that we have that power. We have these choices. We are really in charge with our dollars, with every decision that we make to buy cruelty-free products, to decide to have a vegan meal. That's another wonderful way to help create the beauty and the kindness that we want to in this world.
Agreed. So. Agreed. And another thing that we haven't talked about, I mean, if you want to help animals, donate to a sanctuary like the Gentle Barn and enable sanctuaries to help animals on behalf of you. I mean, not everyone can have 20 acres. Not everyone can run a sanctuary. Not everyone can heal animals, but you can all donate to a sanctuary that can do it on your behalf. Mm-hmm. And that's a way that you're directly helping animals by enabling a sanctuary to help them for you.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up, because it's true. We all have different skills and different jobs, and being able to use our resources in a way that aligns with our soul and our passions. And I think that's a wonderful, it's a gift in a way to be able to do that. And so thank you for mentioning that. And
Yeah, absolutely. We've launched a hay campaign for the month of October, because we need to order hay for all three locations, and it's well over 100 animals that we need to feed for the winter. And so again, I mean, if you're looking for a way to help animals, but you don't have a big backyard, you can't bring in 30 cows, buy hay for the Gentle Barn or another organization and enable them to help animals on your behalf. Like that's such a powerful way to feel like you're contributing.
Yes, yeah. It is. And one of the cool things is there are a lot of sanctuaries. This
yes.
is an important part of our revolution that's happening, this underground gentle revolution that's going on. Just sanctuaries are popping up, and there may be local ones, you know, to volunteer at or donate to. I know Indefensible
yes.
Animals, we have a sanctuary in Mississippi, and oh. Ellie, you've opened up this amazing sanctuary in Missouri. It's just so exciting, all these new sanctuaries that are coming. I think it's a real statement about change that's happening.
I completely agree. I completely agree. There are new sanctuaries popping up all the time. It's so exciting. I think you're so right. It really speaks to where our minds are going. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Well, Ellie, I want to thank you so much for sharing your story with us, and also also congratulate you on your anniversary of 18 years. That is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. And especially such a good treat for us to know like how you did it, the special 5 tools that you shared with us today. So if anyone's just, you know, tuning in, feel free to, we always post replay links, and you're welcome to watch the whole video and make sure you write down those five tools. I certainly am going to. And so I appreciate the time that you've taken today to just let us into your world a little bit and tell us some of your favorite rescue strategies for yourself. I also agree that the news can be a little overwhelming. So I haven't watched it myself in many years. And I find that I do get the information I need without subjecting myself to lots of extra violence. So I think that these are ways to protect ourselves, but it also can keep our heart open to the things that we want to participate in and share in. So thank you for sharing all those wonderful things. And I also wanted to let folks know if anybody does feel so their heart is heavy. I know Ellie was sharing some of the struggles she had as a youngster and growing up and facing the cruelty that's going on. So in defense of animals, we started as part of our sustainable activism campaign, a support line for animal activists. So anyone, and we use that term very broadly, if you're you love animals, you care about animals, you're an animal activist to us. So please, you're welcome to call us and reach out for support. We have counselors on duty who are there for you to help you get through those rough moments and also provide resources for you. So you can call us. The number is 800-705-0425. And you can also look us up on the website, which is idausa.org/activist support. So we're so glad that you could tune in today. Also, Ellie, can you repeat your website so that people can find your organization?
Sure, absolutely. It's gentlebarn.org. And Lisa, that sounds amazing, that support line that you have. That's so great. You guys do such great work.
Well, thank you. And you are welcome to call anytime. It's anonymous. And we do have people who, we've had people who work in sanctuaries call us for support.
Wow.
And we do spend time with people on the phone and really give them all the tools that we have to help them. So
that's so great.
Yeah. So hopefully we can share we'll share the number with your staff too, so they can call if they need to.
Yeah.
Oh, well, thanks to everyone for joining us, whether you tuned in on the webinar or whether you are a part of our Facebook Live. We've got people saying thank you for your five tools and mm-hmm. such lovely comments. And I wanted to just end on that very positive note. And thank you so much, Ellie. I hope that you have a wonderful evening. I know you'll have a good morning because you'll wake up and visualize a beautiful vegan world. In fact, I'm going to do that too. I love that idea. That is so powerful and it's such a great way to frame the day. So thanks to Ellie, and thank you to everyone for joining us. We do these webinars every month, so you can stay tuned to the next one. And we even have one coming up next week with Deanne Thompson of the Humane Society. She's going to share some faith-based activist tools for us. So stay
nice.
Tuned for that.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much. Have a wonderful evening, everyone.
Bye.
Bye, Ellie.
Bye.